I'm Janet Noe.
And I'm Andrea Dillon. We are a mother-daughter CPA firm serving the United States business community with tax preparation services, tax planning, tax resolution, assurance and audits, and CFO outsourcing and consulting.
Thank you for listening to the WOW podcast, Words of Wealth from CPAs of Florida. Learn more at cpasofflorida.com or call us at 239-936-6144.
I want to share some tips that I have for time management, which might seem kind of like a silly thing since I am by no means a personal growth connoisseur or a expert in any of these areas. But what I do know is that we have a very, very cyclical year. I'm a CPA, so we have tax season and then summertime and then extension season and then holiday time. And I have, over the last 10 years, especially as I've had children, had to learn very quickly how to juggle a lot of things while a lot of people need me. My clients need me, my kids need me, my husband needs me, my family needs me, my team needs me, everybody needs me, and there's just not enough hours in the day to make everybody happy. So after many years of pretty much just feeling like I was failing everybody, I slowly figured out a few things that have helped make my life easier. Now, I know that my things are going to be different than some of the other people's things, and my things might not work for you, and that's completely A-okay, and I would love to know what works for other people so that maybe I can continue to get better at this and to continue growing. I am very fortunate in that my field is very deadline-oriented, and while my husband might not love it, I love it. I know that every February, March through April 15th, I am going to be very busy. I'm going to jump from working 30 to 40 hour weeks to working 60 plus hours a week, but I can plan accordingly because I know it's coming. So we can set up childcare help. You know, we can plan vacations around it. We can schedule our lives, which we do, around tax season. I also know there's a light at the end of the tunnel. I know that on April 16th, my life is going to change. I also know that when my kids are off for summer break, I can take time to spend with them. We can do family vacations around when they're not in school. And the same for holidays. After the extension deadlines in September and October, my life slows way down again, sort of. And I'm able to take additional time during the holidays every year. And it's one of the things that drew me to this profession was that I liked the schedule. I knew I was going to have kids one day, and I didn't want to be in a profession where I was going to be pulled away from my family when I believe it matters most. And so I know that it's definitely a stressful time of year when we are busy, and I'm very fortunate that I know when it's going to be busy, and not everybody knows that on April 16th their life is going to, you know, is going to free up. Some people, they don't have a light at the end of the tunnel, and I'm very fortunate that I do. However, I have had to learn how to prioritize and how to manage my time really well because I am only one person, and much as I would love to, I can't multiply myself. So I'm going to give you three tips that I have that help me every day, whether I'm in a busy season of my life or whether I'm in a slower season of my life. I still practice all three of these things, and it helps keep me focused, it helps keep me balanced, and it helps keep me in line. The first thing that I do is set non-negotiables. I'm going to say that again. Set non-negotiables. There's going to be a few things that are important to you, and there shouldn't be a giant laundry list of things. There should just be a handful of things, two or three things that are vitally important to your life, to the way you want to live, the way you need your schedule to operate in order for you to feel like you're living up to who you need to live up to, and then honor those. So for me, one of my non-negotiables is I'm gonna be home for dinner every single night. Family dinners are very important to me. I was brought up with, you know, more nights than not having family dinners. We sit down and do dinner together every single night. And even when I'm crazy busy at work, I will get up really, really early and go into my office or work at home or wherever I'm working while my entire house is still sleeping so that I can still get in the hours that I need to get in and be home in time to have my butt in that seat for dinner, because after dinner comes homework, and then after homework comes bedtime. And all of those things are, to me, are so important to helping my kids be raised the right way and with the right values, that I can probably count on one hand the number of times, even during tax season when I am at my busiest, that I miss dinner, because it really doesn't happen. Unless there's like a sporting event with one of my kids, and you know, my husband is at the baseball field with my oldest. I mean, and we have to divide and conquer. But outside of that, we are home for dinner, and that goes for him too. He is home for dinner. The other thing that I have as my non-negotiable is I don't take calls on my cell phone for work. Now, there's a lot of people that do, and that's great. And it works for a lot of people, especially if they don't have kids at home. So if you're young and you're building your career, or if your kids have already left home, then that's not super important to some people. They're happy to have the work whenever their phone rings, and that's awesome. I've got two reasons for not doing it. One being that my family time is my family time. When I'm at my office, I am on it, and I am 110%, and I am, for the most part, not calling and checking on my kids unless there's something wrong. I'm not calling my husband and seeing how his day is going, because I'm needed every single moment that I'm here by so many different people that I don't really have time to check in with other people that are outside of my work environment unless I need to, unless something is going on, and obviously then I need to be in it. So same thing goes when I'm at home. I don't want my attention to be distracted when I'm supposed to be focusing on my family and on my kids. And I used to get my email, my work email, on my phone. And what happened is I would sit on the couch when everybody was kind of relaxing for the evening and open my email, and then you get sucked in. And then, oh, I've been waiting on that and it just came in, and oh, it'll just take me 5 minutes. And somebody is upset. I need to figure out what's going on. And before you know it, it's been an hour and the kids are in bed and I just lost out on that time with them. So I can access my information from home. I have a computer, a tablet that if I so choose, I can plug into it and I can check. And I oftentimes, when the time is right, but clients don't get my cell phone number, because then they feel that they have the right to pull me away from my kids, and they don't. And I don't call people on their cell phones unless it's during business hours. So when I have somebody who I'm working with professionally's cell phone number, I honor that to them, and I don't reach out to them on their cell phones unless it's during business hours. The other piece of that is that my office has really, really great processes for when the phone rings. And if somebody texts me on my cell phone at 9:15 at night, which happens from people who have it, and I'm putting my kids to sleep and I'm in mommy mode and I see it, and then my four-year-old wakes up and needs something and it goes out of sight, out of mind, my notification goes away, I go to sleep, I wake up the next morning and I completely forget about it because it did not go through my normal processes. And then I don't see it until something suddenly reminds me, and then I'm apologizing for taking so long to get back to them because it skipped the process. So those are my two non-negotiables. I will be home for dinner, and pretty much without exception, I don't use my cell phone for business. You have to define what's important to you. And I mean, if you've got kids, if you don't have kids, my kids are my driving force for having to set these, because I'm needed on so many fronts. Not to say that people who don't have kids aren't, but for me, it pulls a lot of my attention, and it should pull a lot of my attention, because I am the leader, myself and my husband, in my kids' life. And I want to lead them correctly, and I want them to see that they can have a successful career and they can have a family and they can do both well. You might not be winning at both of them all the time, but you can do them both well. So set your non-negotiables. The second thing I do is I define I call them my MITs, my most important tasks. I have no idea what article I read, but maybe 5 or 6 or so, maybe more than that, 7 or 8 years ago, I read an article about what the most successful people do in the mornings to start their day. And across the board, they were all doing something called defining their most important tasks. And what it is I keep a notebook. I'm sure there's an app for it, or you could do it electronically, but I sit at a desk for the majority. Well, I go in and out of a desk between conferences, but you know, my space is my desk. And I have a really pretty notebook that I bought, and every single day, I start my day by defining what are the things I have to do today, the things that are my top priorities, that if I can't get these done today, clients are going to be upset. Team members are going to be upset. My people I work with are going to be upset, myself, whatever. It forces you to prioritize, because everything can't go on your most important task list. I mean, it's supposed to just be a list of, you know, five or six things that are the things you have to get done today. And like on my list right now is a phone call to a client. So they don't all have to be giant time-consuming things, but the phone call is something I have been putting off because it's going to take some time, and with everything going on with coronavirus, the information I need to relay in this phone call is not time-sensitive, and every single person that needs me right now is time-sensitive, so it keeps getting pushed, and that's not fair to that client. So I have a phone call. Sometimes I have send an email on it. Sometimes it is quick and easy things. The other thing that oftentimes goes on it are those things that you put off because they are super not fun to do, so they tend to fall to the bottom of the list, but they're things you really need to do, and nobody else can do them for you. You've got to do them. I like to cross things off my list. It's how I'm wired. That's why I like having a paper list. It sits in front of me all day, so I see it, and as I cross things off of it, I feel like I accomplished things that day. My day could suck. I could have 8,000 people jump into my office needing me. My cell phone could be ringing off the hook with stuff going on with my kids and my personal life. But if I accomplish, you know, more so than I don't on my list for the day, I still at least feel like I made progress that day. And I need to feel that. I need to feel like I'm moving forward. Otherwise, with what I do, I could be in and out of, you know, 100 clients in a day. It's easy to forget about the progress you make and to get bogged down in the details. So I do that every single day. I start my day off by making a list of probably 5 to 7 things that I really need to get done. Preferably today. There's days where it rolls over to the next day, and that's still okay because at least then it gets done the next day. And again, that really just, it forces you to prioritize, because everything can't be the most important task. You can have things that are important, but they can't all be most important. The final thing that I do is to expect fires. And what I mean by that is I could have set my non-negotiables, and I could have defined my most important tasks for today, and my day could tank. I could get a call from my son's daycare, back when daycares were still open, at 9:15, you know, an hour or so after I drop him off, saying that he's got a fever and I have to come pick him up, and I know my husband can't do it, and I get nothing done. I mean, I'm home for dinner, I guess, for my non-negotiables, but, you know, my entire plans for that day just go out the window, probably the next day, because then I'm playing catch up. I could be at my office and have something happen with a client that needs to take priority that was a non-issue until that morning. We're seeing a lot of that right now with the loans that are going on, where people need help and they need help now. So they are jumping in line in front of some of our people who don't really need the help and just want to get their taxes done, and they owe, so they're not super anxious to file. So that means the people who need their refunds because they got fired, and the businesses who need their loans because they're trying really hard not to go under, they are taking priority right now. They have to take priority right now. So sometimes our days are getting out of whack by things that we didn't anticipate in the morning, and that's okay, because the next day I'm gonna start fresh. So the next day I'm gonna wake up and I'm still gonna have my non-negotiables, because those don't change. And I'm still gonna sit there and I'm gonna plan out what I need to get done that day. And a bunch of that list might be stuff that I didn't get done the prior day. And that list grows sometimes as things happen during the day, and I don't wanna forget them. But it's okay to have a day where things don't go as planned, and not to let it bog you down, because we're human and that happens, and to start the next day with a clear head. So those are the three things that I do. Again, I have a very interesting schedule because I know when I'm going to be busy, I know when I'm going to be slow, and I can plan around it. But when I'm busy, I'm really busy. And when I'm slow, I'm still busy. It just changes. Instead of, you know, working on client work, maybe we're working on firm growth, or maybe I'm helping train my team members, or maybe my son has something going on and he needs me to be a part of that so that he can grow into the person I need him to be, or maybe my husband needs me for something. I am always busy and there is never enough time, and I am constantly adjusting this and learning better time management skills. But these three things are what I live by right now: setting non-negotiables and then honoring them, defining my most important tasks every day, and being okay with it if I fail that day, if a fire comes in and I'm not able to get through what I thought I needed to get through. Sometimes that happens. I would love to hear if somebody else has things they want to share about what they do to help prioritize their lives. And I hope that that helped you. And if it didn't, no worries. But I thought I would share it with you, as that's definitely something that we have to know in our profession and in anybody's profession. If you're busy and you're an entrepreneur, or in any sense, if you don't even have to be an entrepreneur to have a busy, filled life. Everybody is busy. I guess not these days. Everybody is staying sheltered at home, but everybody is busy. And I hope that helped shed some light on things that maybe you can take to heart and help you to lead a little bit more organized, not more successful, but you know, to feel like you're moving forward each day instead of feeling like you're bogged down in the details. Thank you so much for tuning in, and have a great day.